Mpumalanga has 12 power stations, and most of the coal mines in the country are also in Mpumalanga.
If you drive on the highways between Pretoria and Middelburg, you can at any stage see at least 3 power stations.
When you're entering Witbank, you can see there's a dark cloud.
Mostly it's from the power plants. Secondly, it's from the blasting that takes place.
Take coal out of South Africa and our economy implodes.
One of the key challenges is the bulk of the coal economy, decades, century of economic development based on coal is concentrated in 2 municipalities. That provides an opportunity for action because we know where to act, but that also provides a crucial challenge.
Most of the towns developed because of the mines and because of the power stations. You get rid of the mines, you get rid of the power stations, you kill towns.
Ghost town straight, even here at Pudding Soap. Maybe in 20 years we'll be a ghost town.
And the majority of people in this province will be without jobs.
Because the entirety of the economy of those municipalities is dependent on coal.
This move away from coal, it's a positive thing. What am I lying? You're wrong.
Coal is food. Coal is life.
Especially in Mpumalanga, Emalahleni, it's life.
It's all I know. So without the coal, there's no jobs.
My lungs are getting blocked because of the dust.
A hidden killer.
A life full of sickness. It's not life.
And the worst part is that the mines are taking the water from the people.
Because that water is contaminated.
It's years we have been talking about this thing.
But we are not being listened.
We sound as if we want to make people choose between your health and earning an income.
So it's a double-edged sword. It's life and death.
I've been reading the news this morning and then they say Eskom is like the biggest sulfur polluter in the world.
This is where it all happens. That's where Unit 1 was. Unit 2, 3, 4, so it continues. And this is the only remaining unit, Unit 9.
These things that were designed for 50 years, extended to 60 years, we're shutting them down. We are doing away with coal.
This is emissions. This is really what the environment does not need. This is the global warming source.
The season itself now is gone haywire. You get winter rain, you get cold in summer. So, ish.
Within a very short space of time from nowhere, the weather changes.
My daughter was saying to me the other day, you know, this summer it's a scam. I have never seen such a summer. It is a scam because most of the time it's summer, but it's so cold.
If you connect all the stories, it becomes easy for you to link with what is happening.
If we are a country that prioritizes the interests of the poor and the vulnerable, then we need to act with greater urgency to respond to the effects of climate change and make our contribution in preventing it.
The message of the president, it's a clear direction. So what one can say in a nutshell, we accept that report. It's us as local municipalities that must see to it that it gets implemented.
We have ratified the Paris Agreement to combat climate change as part of the global effort to dramatically reduce the rate of global warming.
If you look at the IPCC report, and you know, the Paris Agreement talks about trying to limit the warming of the globe to 1.5 degrees, but you have to multiply it by 2 to look at the impacts in Southern Africa. So from a South African perspective, we are very vulnerable, not only to the changes in the climate, but also to our trade partners transitioning as well.
Sayifikile.
Seyifikile. And if everything from South Africa will be boycotted, if we don't comply, then we are dead.
Especially the downtrodden. Where are they in all these things that are happening right in front of our eyes?
Well, climate change is not just an environmental issue. It's never been, right? It's a social issue. It's a political issue. So with all of those elements coalescing, it's very, very clear that we absolutely, that the just transition is a non-negotiable for the country.
The debate is not to transition to a low-carbon economy or not. That's not the debate here. We have to transition, else we have a big, big problem. We are in trouble as a species, and you know, as society. The question is, do we transition in a just or in an unjust way? As we stand, there's no agreement on what we mean by just transition.
There is a real reason for us to move from where we are to a just transition. We understand that. But I'm from the trade unions. Wherever I am, I will resist when it comes to job losses. I would say no.
We are unemployed here. A lot of people that are unemployed. And if you can see this, Hendrina Power is optimum. If optimum can be open and Hendrina Power can function as it was before, you won't see anyone here. You'll be at work, everyone will be at work.
We don't want to see another Hendrina. You cannot close coal-fired power stations and close the mines and think that it's okay. And then go internationally and say, oh, well, we've reduced our carbon footprint by X amount.
Our bread is buttered by this coal. That is why we've got that fear.
Unions and business have to work together, otherwise we all lose.
We're talking about 150,000 direct jobs and an estimated 650,000 indirect jobs.
We're going to be looking at new ways of keeping business going, but supporting greener technologies while we transition out of supporting our existing mines and power stations.
And some people understand that as just transition. Others, more ambitious, see it as a platform to transform society.
We see it as better health services, better transport. We see it as a basic income grant.
Just transition is about us changing the way we live, our lifestyles. It is about us reducing the high rate of consumerism.
There won't be just transition without sustainable development.
Once we get to a cleaner energy, the environment will obviously improve. Biodiversity will improve. Water quality will improve, air quality will improve. So that's why I'm saying it needs to be just, not only just for the communities or for humans, but it also needs to be just for the environment.
We would miss a massive opportunity if we don't pursue that transformative agenda. That means participatory justice, making sure that the process itself is inclusive. And then it's about distributive justice. Whoever loses their job, loses their livelihood as the result of the transition, should have an alternative. And it is also about restorative justice. Can we improve access to services? Can we improve the direct environment of people in terms of air, water, land? Can we have a better economy for all? You know, can we address those historical inequalities?
Just transition for me, it's a paradigm shift.
Often people ask me, what's the most difficult thing you think with the just energy transition? It's not technology, it's mindsets. Having people's mindsets change is the most difficult part, I think.
We are in Emalahleni, right at the heart of coal mining, in an area called Siyangoba, where about 12,000 family units have just been built for the unemployed people. Most of them ex-mine workers, and some of them never even got any form of employment in their lives. So we launched this agroecology initiative as part of our just transition. We are doing our best to foster a paradigm shift. At the moment, the participants, as they are training here, are beginning to enjoy this.
I like planting, I like nature.
Gradually, they are regaining that love for the soil.
As black people, we are happy because when we grow up, we're knowing that white people are those who are having the farms. Now, I see many people are inspired.
Let's tell the truth. The land is the life in the soil. Life isn't there without clean water and the clean air. Life isn't there without the food that we are producing. So that's all what we are trying to do in order to make our contribution towards the reduction of climate change, moving society away from the current destructive economic activities, which are not sustainable.
The mines are moving in the center of the community. They're blasting each and every day.
The landowner, municipality, they got the permit to rehabilitate. While they are mining, blasting, they are claiming that they are rehabilitating. The municipality gave them the permission.
Unfortunately, we find local governments sandwiched in a position where they understand what the issues are on the ground, but they're unable to influence a lot of them because these decisions get made at national level departments.
We had a huge complaint where acid mine water was overflowing through Olifants River. So I tried by all means to get DMR, but I got coffee.
We have tried and tried, you know, to get DMR to sit with us so that we can talk about these issues, so that we can find solutions around these issues, but all in vain.
We don't have those powers. They told us, "Good Nina, who are you, Nina? We don't get permission from you. We get permission from DMR."
We are talking about the just transition, but why are still these licenses being given out? If we are serious about moving from coal to clean energy.
As organs of state, we need to talk in one voice. When the president speaks, the minister should not contradict him.
Somehow there is a contradiction on what we are saying, what we are planning to do. On the other hand, DMR is giving licenses like nobody's business. Then we ask yourself, are we really serious? Are we moving together or what?
It's still business as usual. I will tell you, in Emalahleni, I don't see any. There are new mines emerging every day. So it tells you that the licenses are still being issued out.
Actually, it is government that is confusing the private sector and our community. Hence, they are not going to buy into our concept very easy.
I don't know whether they are trying to fool us or they're trying to cover up.
All we can do is to talk to province. Province must talk to national, and then that's where it becomes complicated.
So I need that cooperative governance framework to be fully implemented, all organs of state talking to one another to achieve the same goal, which is to serve the community. We are the servants of the community.
So that's where I think the central government is lacking, because they are not really telling us how are we going to do it. Now I'm speaking like as an employee of local government, how are we going to do it? It is not clear how it's going to be done.
The state must create an environment in which the private sector can invest and unleash the dynamism of our economy.
So I think corporations, you know, some of them willingly, but some of them are being forced by their shareholders and the investors to change that mindset.
But equally, it is also an environment in which South Africans can live a better life and unleash the energy of their capabilities.
When you talk to investors now, they're no longer looking at what is your bottom line profit. They're also looking at what are you doing about the environment? How are you protecting social growth and social welfare?
No one must be left behind.
Most big companies have what they call a CSI budget, which they have to spend. And that has to be spent on the communities that are around the mines.
Capital is mobile. They just destroy and migrate. We need to look at how much are these companies giving vis-a-vis the environmental liability that we are inheriting as communities. We pay the heavy price.
It's always going to come down to also profits. You want to make a living and you want to do well. You want to keep people employed.
But these companies are hiding behind the corporate social responsibility or the SLPs. They are not addressing that which is actually essential for us, the transformation of our society to a better one.
I think if mining companies were more ethical and more caring, I think most companies could do a lot more.
If I can mention one Ward 7, there's a mining house out there. They do almost everything for that community out there. From the infrastructure in building a clinic, a hall, some houses, and all that, they do it in partnership with our local economic development desk. They don't just come into a community and say that we've got this, we don't mind about the municipality or government, this is our money. No, they follow two processes. That's Mafube code.
I'm very lucky to work for companies that are committed to ensure that we implement the commitments that we have made throughout our permits. Across the mill field, that's our discard dump. There will usually be acid drainage. The aim of the project is what to do with the water that remains after mine closure. So what we are looking at is to have the water from the mine and you can use that for farming purposes, instead of for 50 years trying to treat water, which is most costly when you compare to this exercise.
So the water that is actually a liability for the mines is now becoming a great asset.
The other mines are interested. A number of people were contacting us to understand the key issues that we are looking at, especially in terms of the water qualities and how do we identify an area where we can do such farming projects.
So corporate social responsibility, yes, we will welcome it to intervene, but it must not intervene to maintain the status quo.
And we have to change the way that we think and our expectations, because, I mean, we all grew up thinking, you know, you have to make a lot of money to be successful. And I think that whole paradigm has to shift. And that you actually, the whole respect for different cultures, different communities and nature has to actually be taught at school.
In order for us to make meaningful shift, we need workers and community people to be involved. They haven't been included in decision making. But I mean, if somebody knew that living in this area would impact negatively on his or her health, I don't think they would have taken such a decision. I mean, they would have demanded a better place to live in.
There's a need for more education, more awareness, raising around climate change, why there's this need to move away from coal.
We're here running capacity building workshop. The ultimate idea is to take what we hear on the ground and feed it back into national level policies where the big decisions happen.
Because the way the politics works in South Africa, the decisions on how things happen from on top.
We need actions, and I feel as if us as the community in Mpumalanga, we are not doing enough.
The transition is happening and we're still trying to fight and find more jobs in coal. So by the time we look this side, they would have set it up according to their plans, not according to what we need.
Because now we are talking of a just transition, a fair change. What will be fair if we are not involved as communities? Because at the end of the day, those policies bind us.
We haven't had a community engagement strategy as a province. I think we've been reactionary in our action. So it becomes very important that we bring those community structures in as early as the planning phase of any development that will take place within a certain community.
There's a lot happening in this space. The Mpumalanga province are actually developing a just transition framework. It's the first in the country. Will link with PCC work and the work happening at the municipal level and deal with some of the issues that you have raised today around managing health, education, and bringing in national government more strongly.
So building those alliances and working together, because there's common issues amongst the various stakeholders and they've just been talking at each other instead of to each other and coming up with collective solutions.
What do you want to do?
everybody needs to start sitting around the same table and actually presenting what their plans are. Because at the moment, everything is happening in silos and everybody is doing their small little projects on their own, and it's costing a lot of money and it's not sustainable because it's too small.
The Green Cluster is a structure that is going to coordinate all activities around your green economy, bringing together all the stakeholders that are operating in the province. The cluster is conceptualized on the basis of a triple helix model. It will bring in government, business, and academia is working with us.
One of our biggest problems is to move this from a totally unwanted concept into something where now Department of Water Affairs is highly interested. 2 years ago, they called this one of their flagship research projects.
The crop is standing beautifully. I think the harvest will be really good this year.
Mining happens all over the world. So if we can actually skill the community in how to rehabilitate the soil and the water, we can actually start an agricultural value chain.
It's really growing nicely.
With passive water treatment, you revitalize wetlands. And as soon as you've got wetlands re-established, birds will come back and animals will come back. Then you can maybe look at tourism.
We can move away from the coal, but what are you going to replace it with for us?
Before they bring something, they must bring skill first. They can't just bring something and say, no, we need artisans like this and this and this without any trainings.
Over the next 10 years, 10 billion is going to be spent in the province of Mpumalanga on your just transition.
I don't have an idea of solar. I know that solar is for electricity and stuff and needs sun. Then after that, when solar is there, who's going to maintain it? Maybe if they can train us for that.
People are losing jobs. So we want to reskill these people and prepare them.
We need to start creating those jobs to show that, yes, there are some alternatives. This could be in energy. This could be in manufacturing, in agriculture, in tourism.
The best thing is to focus on alternatives, because these alternatives are the ones that are going to actually deliver us the future.
And until we create those new jobs, whoever is set to lose is going to resist the transition.
We are a developing state. Could it be that we want to measure ourselves with the developed world now?
It's because we know better now. If I can use an analogy, we leapfrogged in Africa from landlines to mobile telephony. If you look at how that just took off on the continent, you know, everybody could have a phone. We did not say, well, no, let's just try this landline thing first, since everybody else did it, and then move to mobile technologies, because we recognize this was something better. So if we can use that analogy to explain the electricity, we recognize that there is something better now.
So engage us, call us in all the engagement, so that we understand the train, where the train is going, so that we don't miss the point, or we do all this work. Then at the end of the day, we find the resistance.
This is where we are heading. The intended projects will take another while being developed, but we have put up these demonstration ones. It's very good for ourselves, our employees, and the community, so they can start smelling what is coming in here.
The community is very excited about the repowering and repurposing program. Because, you know, in the past when Eskom shut down plants, it literally was a shutdown and then the land was sold and you moved out of the areas.
But because we already have an infrastructure, and critically because of the people that have come to depend on Komati, it would have been very inhuman for a business which is owned by a government to just shut and disappear.
We are here to experience what Eskom is now trying to transform into. Now, we want to see this happening in our municipality. Hence, we show an interest out here.
There's a wonderful microgrid pilot project we have in Vicksburg in the Free State, where we have 25 homes connected up to a solar microgrid plant.
We test next horizon technologies. So the rural microgrid in Vicksburg has demonstrated that the reliability of these plants have now proven themselves. That transition to a greener future is something that we are busy with. Projects such as this microgrid ticks all those boxes in terms of social upliftment, supplier development, localization, upliftment of communities.
The model at Ficksburg is very interesting because we have what we call community ownership of the plant. It's 25 homes, all women-headed households.
I cook with my electric, I light my electric inside. I got hot water, I wash with them every morning.
The other thing about this community was 2017, when their plant went live, was the first time they had electricity.
Ah, my life. Ooh, well, so difficult before.
No. And now we've reduced this plant to this containerized option.
This is an equivalent of that panel down in Ficksburg. It's in commission as it stands.
You can actually pack those panels into the container and transport it anywhere in the country. And then you set down the container in the area where you want to get electrification going, and you connect up that community. It's as simple as I'm saying it.
At Komat, you are shutting down. The workers that are there, what are they going to do once the station shuts down?
We will be able to assemble these here at Komati for distribution to wherever they are required.
If that's proven, we copy it at Tendrina, we do it at all the other stations that are here marked to be shut down.
If any organization come to us as communities, we must discuss the solutions. We know all of us the problems. We don't need to discuss the problems anymore.
Stop the talk shops. And actually just, we're going to make lots of mistakes, but if we don't get the spade in the ground, we don't know what the mistakes is that we need to learn from. So we're really pushing on getting in there, working with the communities and starting these projects, because we've been talking for long enough now.
South Africa has the tools to achieve a just transition on all fronts. The democratic process in the pre-94 and immediate democratic era was very vibrant. Grassroots mobilization, the emergence of the constitution, many of those dynamics were really inclusive. That provides the opportunity to rekindle really that process. And then if you look at it in terms of creating better society, better livelihoods, all the policy tools that are required to do that are known and have been used to some extent to achieve a great deal of progress actually since 1994. The question is, can we re-harness the potential effectively of those tools to have a just transition going forward? We know what needs to be done. The question is, you know, do we have the political will to do it? And are the interests of all aligned?
I was born on the day they landed on the moon, and that was actually the first time where they took a picture of Earth and actually realized this is the finite, this is all we have. And I think that's why I'm so passionate about that, because in the 1970s, there was a definite realization for the first time ever that we really need to look after our only home.
The natural environment works as a system. If the air is affected, the water component at some stage will be affected. The biodiversity component will be affected. And all these are the basic components where we derive our livelihood. So we should not neglect one component of the environment and say, let it be so because it's not affecting me at this stage.
What we are not aware of is that at the end of the day, there won't be any jobs in a dead planet.
The environment has no boundary, so we need to watch that space and make sure that whatever we do is for the betterment of our community. Thank you.